It's time that I concluded. It's become so long, nobody will ever have time to listen to all of it. Oh, cold, cold day. When the roads were frozen, the ruts were frozen so hard that buggies could hardly travel over them. It was March 11th, 1912. A child was born. And it didn't. It was of no importance to the world, only to the dear ones who loved her. And on that day, I began a journey, as we all must. Not from birth to death, or from here to hereafter, or from the known to the unknown. But the journey is simply from sense to soul. And the way I learned this wonderful truth is that the most significant thing that ever happened to me was when I discovered and accepted the teachings of Christian Science. My whole outlook was changed, and I would never again think like my parents or my peers. Over the years, my progress has been pretty slow, and I've made many, many mistakes. But I hope I've come through it all with some small measure of grace. And I love you.
Sister. chief of police in Columbus, and he had a daughter named Elaine. She was very dark, as I remember. And Big didn't know I was kin to her, but he said to me one time, "I look like Elaine Lawson." I don't think I was flattered. That bunch carried on nonsense all the time. Felix would come by and he'd stop the car and he'd say, "Hey, Doc, I want to borrow your galoots." And it seemed like there were some tacky people around here named the Raiders. And one of them was notorious for saying stupid things. And in those days, they called a man's luggage a valise. And that guy called him a galoots. And they thought that was a big joke. And anyway, there was twin girls, Ari and Effie. Now, I don't remember Effie. She married old Bob Patterson, who was mean to her, so it went. And she died young, but her son, Pat Patterson, ran a popular restaurant in Columbus for a long time. I didn't know him. Ari, the other twin, married Lane and Hart. And one of my first memories is of her family. They lived at that time at my great grandfather's grand's place. And they weren't related to him, but they lived in that house when I first remember. But then they moved away from the grange. Somewhere out in the country from the Grange. And we used to go to see them sometimes. You remember Blanche Yarbrough? Well, she was their oldest child. And also Omen and Lois's wife, who used to come to Mama's and Daddy's a lot. Now, Omen was a fine man. He was on the Grange police force until he retired. My Aunt Ari had the sweetest, kindest voice, like Uncle Ben. That's all I can recall about Daddy's mother's family. Some I knew and some I didn't. Some I just heard of. Aunt Juliet supposedly had a temper. And some of them were on the blonde side. And some were very dark. That's where Daddy got his black curly hair, I guess. Although he had a vague memory of his mother being a lighter reddish-haired person. Daddy always said he had red hair when he was small. And there was never any photos of those grandchildren. And when they were little, I wished many times I had one. I guess they were too poor to had any pictures made. Another tale that they told me about Ma Hart, Daddy's grandmother, Daddy said she put all her dishes in a pot in the yard occasionally and boiled them. And that was a good idea. Believe it or not, I used to take Mama's pots and pans out in the yard and scrub them with sand. There was no SOS in those days. It was told that Pa Hart wanted to eat some kind of canned thing, pickles, I think, that she had, and she wouldn't let him eat them. So when he passed on, she would never let anybody eat those pickles. The Harts were all members of the Primitive Baptist Church, Harmony Church. That's why so many of them were buried down there. And according to the history of Harris County, that was a very popular church. And there was a school close by there. Now, I remember it being a very small church, which I believe it was blown away in a storm. and the lambs returned to the heirs of the ones who gave it in the beginning. It was right across the road from the cemetery. This brings me to another thing you might remember. Our connection with Mrs. Mary B. Lawson, the practitioner. Well, actually, there is no connection. We were not kin to them, but we were both kin to the same people. Now, Miss Weedy, as we all called her, married Will Lawson, another one of the Lawson men, who was a brother of Aunt Ella, who married Uncle Charlie Beers, my mother's uncle, just as Lynn Lawson married Daddy's aunt, Juliet. Now, I had known the Lawsons since I was a small child, since they came to Aunt Ella's and Uncle Charlie's pretty often. Now, in talking with Louise Davenport recently, I was reminded that there were two more Hart men. One was named Ress, and one was named D. Now, I remember hearing the word D. Hart when I was a child, and I got the idea that whoever that was his last name, D. Hart. I'm sorry that I didn't include this little bit of information in the original tapes I made, but I just didn't realize that I knew as much about the Harts as I did till I started to dragging up all these memories. And I was just trying to stick to things that people who played a part in my childhood, and some of them did. I believe that my daddy's mother must have been the oldest one of the Hart children, because Louise thinks that she was. I thought of something else the other day, connected with my childhood and my upbringing, and that was the literature, the books that we had, or didn't have, as the case was. We took a daily newspaper, the Columbus Inquirer's Sun, it was called. There was a ledger then, too, but the Inquirer was the morning paper. And it came up on the train and was carried out by the mail carrier and put in our mailbox. And, of course, we didn't have any other way to get news. But then we didn't take any magazines except one that I remember. And that was a publication that looks something like the Grit does now. And it was named the Comfort. And up at the top, on the outside, it was very like newspaper print almost, you know, not slick. And it had a key and the word Comfort. And the key went through the letters of the word Comfort. It was the key to comfort. And it had, I think some of the novels of that day were published in serial form. And we couldn't wait to get it every month because it had a little story about Cubby Bear, the little bear. And I was real thrilled with that one. And Mama would read that to me every month. And if I had had access to a library, I don't know what I would have done. I wanted more than anything in the world after I got a little older to have the Zane Grey books. I only had a few of them, and then, of course, we exchanged books with each other because other people didn't have any either. Some of my friends had some of the Bobbsey twins. I don't know, they may still have published those. And Charles Beers had the Rover Boys. That was a popular series of books for boys, and I just ate those up. And we didn't have a Sears catalog. We had the National Cloak and Suit Company catalog, and I think that's where Mama ordered her coat suits, as she called them. They were, it was a skirt, and you wore it with a blouse, and it had a kind of a three-quarter length coat. That was the style in those days. And because we always had the almanac, and I would get it down to see if maybe it was going to snow sometime. Because it never did. Of course, later on, Mama subscribed to McCall's and Ladies' Home Journal. And they were nothing like they are now. With all their sex articles and stuff, Mama wouldn't have had them if they had been. But they had, the popular novels of the day were in serial form. In those, and they were very good. Mama was a talented seamstress. I don't mean that she could make high fashion clothes, but having married so young, she was determined that she would learn how to sew and make all the clothes. And she told me she even made Betty long drawers when they first married. And she would make all of my clothes. I never knew there was any other way to get clothes. And I still have some of the patterns she used making my first school clothes. And before school started, she made me several little dresses to wear. I probably had a change every day. And I remember when I got older, we played basketball. I tell you, the things we wore were something else. They were like, they were pleated black sateen bloomers. And many times girls lost them in on the basketball court because they were made with buttons and they were very long. They were nothing like shorts. And that old black sateen was stinking. It had the strangest smell to it. But unfortunately, I didn't like to play basketball, so I didn't have to wear them too much. She made costumes for everything that went on at school. Indian suits. I still have some of the things here. And then when Jerene lived with her and I went to Harris County School, she made costumes for her. And they had bought an old Singer sewing machine. Of course, it was the kind that you pedaled. And Mama would keep it running in tip-top condition because having inherited mechanical know-how from the Beerses, she could always keep a machine going. And a lot of times she would make things for other people. She probably didn't charge them 50 cents, but she did a lot of sewing for a lot of people. And it seemed so easy for her. Now, she bought me a sewing machine like that. It was a secondhand thing. And I used it for a long time when my children were little because I was determined that I would learn how to sew. But I never learned how to sew as well as my mother did. But I tried not to take things to her to finish. I tried to finish things myself so that I could say I did it.
I touch them and they burst apart with caves and twilight's trimmed in purple haze, and laughing eyes and simple ways, and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like trimmed in purple haze, and laughing eyes and simple ways, and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Memories. Memories.